you. Our moderator, Anna, already made some introduction to this debate about the significance of the far-right participation in Maidan. And some people, including me, were emphasizing this participation, or at least trying to bring attention and critical attention to this participation, and actually warning about the dangers of this far-right significant participation in Maidan protests. Other people, like Andreas, for example, were saying that this participation may be exaggerated, it may be exaggerated precisely because of the Russian interest in discrediting the protest, that actually our far-right parties are not really fascist, the ethnic nationalists or national conservatives. And if you look comparatively, probably the Putin regime would be even more fascist than our far-right parties. And despite this, and of course the electoral results, in presidential elections, parliamentary elections, I can actually give a kind of credence to this argument that look, the Ukrainians do not support far-right parties, the Svoboda and right sector were below the 5% limit, so on. Although the electoral participation, electoral success and protest mobilization actually took quite different activities and require very different resources, so it's, you cannot actually infer from the electoral results insignificant participation in the protest. So the question was actually about how can we systematically measure what was the real participation and impact of the far right organizations, parties, foremost the Svoboda Party and the right sector in the Maidan protest. And there were very little of them. One of them was the most probably known measure were the surveys done by Kyiv International Institute of Sociology and the Democratic Initiative Foundation, which showed that this was the service among the participants of Kyiv Maidan and participants of Kyiv rallies in December and January, showing that only a small minority of participants were belonging to any political party, and also obviously including the far right, like 4-7%, and claiming that the nature of Maidan was mainly grassroots, non-partisan, and involving mass participation. And that was an insightful estimate, but what it lost that, first of all, it's we cannot generalize from Kyiv rallies what was happening all around Ukraine. And Maidan, as the data which I will show, Maidan was all national event. And much more important events were actually happening in probably in Western Ukraine than in Kyiv, or at least as important as in Kyiv. And another problem is that these surveys cannot catch the very important impact of active minorities within the protest, which may exceed by far the numerical strength and numerical participation. So we have, I would say, better data. And how it works? Yeah. For 5 years, our team, first in the Center for Society Research and in the Center for Social Labor Research, were systematically collecting all protest events taking place in Ukraine in real time, plus negative and positive reactions to these protests. And we were doing the systematic monitoring of up to 190 national, but mostly regional web media covering local news for each Ukrainian oblast. And the majority of the sources are actually regional media. And in the end, we have a complete database of all protest events taking place during the whole period of Yanukovych rule, starting from the end of 2009 and going up to 2014. These are around 25,000 events. These data sets are published, and the methodology is also published on our website. And to understand, I don't have time to go into the methodology, but just to let you understand what precisely I will speak later. We code each reported action from the media report. So, for example, when the march starts and then the fight starts and then it receives the repression from the police, this will be three different events, coded in our database. But if the event is going on for many days, it will be still one event. Because in many cases, we do not know the ending date of the event, and it would be kind of creating a methodological bias if you will calculate each day separately. So what we see about Maidan from our data, you saw this picture already yesterday, and these are actually our data, and of course, the Maidan created a huge splash of protest events, in several times exceeding the previous intensity of protest events, also of confrontation violence events. Not all of these protests were actually around or in solidarity with Maidan, but over 80% of them, they were in some way in support or in solidarity with Maidan. 350 protests, a small minority were anti-Maidan, and some number of protests were not connected to neither Maidan or anti-Maidan. And this graph you didn't see, this is actually important, the geographical distribution of Maidan protest events. And you can see here that the Kyiv events were just 13% of all Maidan protest events. Two-thirds of protest events in support of Maidan took place in Western region and in Central region. And we look at these events with much less attention. They actually deserve to. That's in comparison with the protests in 2013 before Maidan started, just to give some context. So the share of protest events in Western and in the Central regions increased heavily. Not the best graph, but it's kind of like difficult to create a map and so on. And these events were particularly important. I mean, the regional events. Here you see the two lines of showing all protest, all Maidan protest events compared to Kyiv Maidan. And you can see that these peaks were following the events in January, the second half of January, when the violence started, and also the end of February, when the final stage of Maidan uprising started. So the regional events were very, very, very important and very significant. And finally, what about the actually far-right participation? For each event, we quote all the participants which were mentioned by the media. In the result, we received such a picture. This is the most visible participants in Maidan protest events. I am emphasizing that this is the visibility. This is because our sources are media. In many cases, journalists didn't report specific participants, or they were reporting about them in a very generic way, for example, Euromaidan activists, or just citizens, or just protesters, and we cannot know who exactly were those protesters. But in many cases, they reported. And this is the reported, this is the kind of estimate of a visibility of participation of the most notable collective agents within Maidan. And you can also see that the Svoboda participation was not really increasing during Maidan compared, for example, to the protests in 2013 before Maidan started. Svoboda was the most protestfully active party among all other parties for at least since 2010, since we have this systematic data. Their participation in the protests were exceeding the participation of all other parties, and it was growing. So, yeah, to claim that their participation was just invented by Russian media, that it was just Russian propaganda, it really doesn't explain this picture. Why even before this attack on Ukrainian fascism started in Russian media, we saw a high participation of Svoboda in the protest events in Ukraine? And moreover, here you can see the graph showing a growing percentage of opposition protest events, protests with the participation of moderate opposition parties, Batyushchina and Front Zmin, with and without Svoboda. And gradually, from year to year, there were protesting together with Svoboda more and more, in both in relative estimate and in an absolute estimate. So what appeared in Maidan was very much natural coalition. And high visibility, high participation of Svoboda in Maidan protest was a natural continuity of the protest coalition which emerged earlier. And I have some hypothetical explanations for that, because Batkivshina and Front Mir were mainly electoral machines with a low number of really committed activists, very often using paid participation, so-called flagomache, so basically paying people to create a visibility of kind of like mass mobilization, mass support, but they needed a truly ideological, truly mobilization-based Svoboda party with strong local cells in many towns and settlements to be present in the protest events. And this is participation in violent events during Maidan. The violent events which had a specific significance for Maidan success, and also, naturally they received more attention. Here we have a dominance of right sector, and the Svoboda Party is on the second place. Moreover, the far right, Svoboda, and later right sector were the most visible participants in the Maidan events during all the stages of Maidan. During the last stage of Maidan, starting from February 18, Svoboda, as well as other parties, they decreased their visibility. But the right sector, together with Maidan self-defense, increased to a large extent. And finally, this is a regional distribution of Maidan protest events. And very kind of like the most counterintuitive finding, at least for me, that against expectations, we see the higher percentage of Maidan protests with participation of political parties and far right in Donbass, in the eastern region. And this share is larger than in western region, than in the central region. So precisely in those regions where the grassroots support for local Maidans was lower, and the opposition parties didn't have majority support, and they were actually distrusted by the local population, precisely in those regions, local Maidans had to rely on their organizational structures. And what it led on the following step, that the local Maidans were ever more discredited for the local populations. So preventing Maidan to become a truly all-national revolt. In the end, creating the grounds for the civil war, which we see now. At least that dimension of the war, which we can call a civil war and not Russian invasion. And of course, in this situation, Russia takes probably a huge part of responsibility of what is happening. But also we should remember about the responsibility of the far right, of radical Ukrainian nationalists, and also about the responsibility of those liberal and moderate opposition people, opposition parties against Yanukovych, who were tolerating Ukrainian far right, who were silencing them, who were downplaying their participation, and didn't break away with them when it was necessary.